Welcome to the YouTube channel for Bible Biker Church in Rockwood, Tennessee. I am Fred Marshall, Elder and Associate Pastor. We pray that what you're about to see is inspiring to you as it is the truth in the Word of God, as it is written. We pray that it blesses you and anyone that you share it with. If you like what you see, please click on the like button and subscribe to our channel. Also know that you can find us on Facebook under the page name Bible Biker Church. Thanks and have a blessed day. All right, well, good morning, Bible Biker Church. How y'all doing this morning?
Good.
A lot of stuff going on in here this morning. We ask that you should be in prayer for all the stuff that's going on. But in the meantime, we're still going to have service, okay? So if you can, stand up and join with me and sing a little bit. How about that? Maybe, if I remember to turn the sound off.
Lord of heaven and
something else just to throw in the mix this morning. Like I say, I thought I downloaded the one with the video with the lyrics, but...
Oh, well, I'll fix that. No big deal.
Absolutely.
Video messes up.
Yeah.
Holy Spirit takes over.
Wait for the lights to start blinking. Ain't lunch time yet, that's true. Anyway, let's sing one more. Let's see what this one does. Try to
help best we can. That's what we're here for. So, a couple of quick announcements. I know there is a Frosty Toes ride Tuesday for those that are able to go. Get with Brother Will about that. I will not be going. I was able to go for a little while this past Friday on the bike, but I got a phone call from somebody in the church while I was gone. There was police sitting at my house, so yeah, it happens. Leaving mom alone for any amount of time right now is just not going to work. So anyway, but that's okay. Second part of that, for those of you that have access to the facility, know that we now have a security system installed up and running.
Amen.
The reason I'm doing that, I got a question about, you know, why would a church have to, you know, put in a security system? Why would we have to lock the doors and stuff like that? It's because we're targets. Vandalism, of theft, of whatever, whatever, whatever. But also, because of the way this building has done in the past, I'm getting water detection system in here as well. That's part of that security system. So if the water comes in the back wall again, we'll know and we'll be able to get in and get it out quickly. It's happened since we built the chapel. So it wasn't very much, just it came out into the floor in here. So, you know, it's just one of those things where we're trying to do what's right. So it's just, it's taking a little bit of time. Reason I say that though is because he's, notice that nice little keypad by the door. Don't, please don't play with it. It makes an alarm beep inside the house whenever you touch a key. So, just like the doorbell, you know, it rings inside the house. So and it does to get the police called, yes. So just be aware of that. Be aware of that. Again, I mentioned it. We have the Iron Sharpens Iron Men's Conference coming up Saturday, March 2nd. All day in Chattanooga. If any man is interested in going to this, the church will be picking up the cost for this. We've made that agreement, so it's pretty neat. This will be the fifth time I've been there, and this will be the third time that Brother Will's been there. It is an amazing thing. It's like I say, an all-day men's conference where last year I think it was 412 men. 416 men maybe in a room praying together and focused on God. And then we split off into, they have 16 different individual sessions over different topics for different age groups. So any male 18 to whatever can go to this. Just let us know if you're interested. If the weather's nice, we're going to try to ride down. If not, of course, we'll take the vehicles. But that's still coming up. Last week we celebrated the birth of our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
What do we celebrate this year?
New Year.
Jesus. Oh. Jesus.
Thank you. I thought I was going to have a lesson all over again. We can celebrate the birth of Jesus every day, but celebrating Jesus in our heart every day is something that we absolutely should do, okay?
Absolutely.
Absolutely should do. So. Other than that, we still have the prayer box or the spiritual ammunition box back there on the side. If you have any prayer requests, anything going on in your life or the life of a neighbor, a friend, a family member, write it on that card, put it in that box because they do get prayed over during the week here. Okay. Also, if you have a heartfelt giving, we don't pass a collection plate here, but it does cost money to run the ministry. That would be where you do it. That's between you and God. It has nothing to do with us. We don't get paid for doing this. So it's just money to keep the ministry going. Okay? Yes, sir.
One thing about running the ministry that everybody should understand is what we say when we say running the ministry, we mean giving to others in the community. That's what our ministry is. And we get several calls and several requests of people asking for help. And so far, we've pretty much been able to help people with what they need. And that's really, they don't have to go to this church. They don't have to commit to saying they're going to go get saved if we help. They don't have to commit to anything, and they don't have to pay it back unless God puts it on their heart to pay it forward. So when we say for running the ministry, it's important to know that our food pantry, people in the community that are struggling and need help, and get to the point to where they don't feel like they have anyone, we like to show them that Jesus works through our ministry to help others. So what we get, what we take in from that allows us to help more people.
Right. Right. All right, looking forward into the springtime, because I hate winter. I do. Not only do we have rides coming up and things like that, we also have work coming up. We got a line yesterday on enough wood to extend the chapel all the way over to the edge of the garage. We're going to start by building a, I don't want to call it a lean-to, more of a pavilion style, with a platform and a roof. That's where we'll start. And praise God, if this works out, that wood won't cost us anything. Okay? I went and took a look at it Friday, and I'm just excited. I'm so excited when I got to see all that stuff, and it's like, if the church wants it, to build something. So, just waiting on the final approval for everything, and then the work starts, because it's part of a building. So we'll need volunteers to go over there and help cut it out. And then once we start building here, of course, we'll need help in doing the expansion work. Of course, it's all going to be done, you know, weekend work, whatever. Church will feed you. You know, that's just something we do. There we go again, talking about food. You know, why is it that the micro church always talks about food? Well, it's because that's the time we get to fellowship together and celebrate what Jesus is doing in our lives. Amen?
Amen.
Because if we just accept what he has done, we're in heaven. But if we don't share that with other people, they may not be. That's where the fellowship comes in. We sharpen each other in fellowship so that we can also extend that out to other people. Okay? So that's what's going on. And if there's anything else, send me a text message or a message on Facebook, or, you know, write a letter if you have to. It'll get here eventually. I might read it, I might not, but anyway. I'm teasing. Anyway, let me go ahead and open stuff in a word of prayer, especially with all the stuff going on today. So let me just do that for us. Heavenly Father, Lord God, again, we thank you for this place that you've given us. Father, this place where we can come and we can talk to you and we can cry out into your name. Lord, help us get through life, Lord, because it's such a struggle. Lord, and for those that are suffering this morning, we just ask you, Lord, hold on to them. Lord, support them. Lord, heal them from what's going on. Father God, we pray for Greg Johnson as he's sick. We pray for Kevin and Darla as they're sick, Lord, and for the others that are here struggling with things that are going on. Father, and for those that wanted to be here but couldn't because they had to work today, Lord, we ask you to be with them as well. Bring them back into your time. But Father God, for those that are here and those that are making it in here for the first time, Lord, just be with them. We don't call them out, we don't single them out, but we want them to feel welcome because they came here to hear about you, and that's what we teach here, Father God, and we thank you for all of that. Father, once again, I thank you for everything you're doing to us, through us, and for us in this place. In Jesus' holy and precious name, and all of God's people said,
amen.
No doubt. Stand up with me one last time if you can. And if you feel this way, make sure you shout this out from your heart, because this is how I feel.
My heart screams, I am free. Yes, I am.
Preaching about. I come in the morning and I pray, especially over the four corners of the building, and then I build the song list by what God leads me to. You'll see in a few minutes why that's so funny, that once again, God has put us together for a reason. All right? But for now, sit back, relax, and enjoy.
Here we go.
At our church, Jesus is Lord. That simple belief calls us together as a community and sends us into our world with hope and purpose. At our church, your past will never define your future. There's always redemption, which means there's always a brighter day. At our church, we don't think we're better than any other church out there. We're just doing our best to become our best. At our church, we want you to believe in God, but we also want you to know that God believes in you. We are not against people who don't attend church anywhere. Instead, we pursue them with love, the very same love that's pursuing us. At our church, we're learning to serve God with all our hearts, and we're learning to worship Him with all our lives. And if you're looking for the perfect church, we're not it. At our church, we will make mistakes, but we will choose to grow from them. At our church, we're part of a global community that's knit together by the resurrection of Jesus. And by the way, at our church, we believe that really happened too. At our church, we will engage with people who are in real need because we are the hands and the feet of Christ. And finally, we need you to hear this loud and clear. At our church, it's not really our church at all. It's His. And we live and move and breathe in His church for His glory and His fame, not ours. So here's the invitation. You're invited to jump in with your whole heart at your own pace and to experience the life that awaits you in Christ. Friends, this is going to be good. Welcome to our church.
Morning. I want to welcome everybody in here. As most of you know, I'm Brother Will. I'm the pastor. God has put it on my heart today to talk about something that sometimes we kind of misconstrue. Sometimes we stretch it. Sometimes we lean on it. Sometimes we turn away from it, and that's the truth. Talk about the truth today. You know, our motto is John chapter 8 verse 36. It says, if the Son therefore shall make you free, you shall be free indeed. necessary. So in St. John verse chapter 8 verse 32, Jesus is telling the Jews, and he's talking to the ones, he's told the Jews that, that follow with him, you know, if you continue to believe in me, you are my disciples. And he says, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. We always hear that. We always hear that everywhere we go. The truth shall set you free. Well, there's a lot of different ways to take that verse. You know, because a lot of people can be burdened by the truth. Because for some reason in this day and time, we find it real easy to walk away from the truth. But once you walk away from the truth, or once you turn from the truth, it's really hard to get back to the truth. You know, you could, let's say you get caught doing something, and you want to turn back around and say that, no, I didn't really do that, and you make up a reason of how you couldn't have done that. You know, you've not told the truth. Now, how do you come back to the truth and tell somebody what you actually were doing if you've already told a lie? You know, that verse right there, it doesn't necessarily mean that example that I gave. This says that you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. The truth that they're talking about is the same thing that you talk about with the word, the light. That's, they're talking about Jesus. Jesus is the truth. And how many times do we see in our lives today as Christians, or how many times did we do it as non-Christians, or even as someone that came and got saved, and we turn away from Jesus? You end up being burdened by sin. That's why you're not free. When you're not saved, you're not free. You're bound by sin. And being bound means you're actually, you're just tied down with it. You can't get free. You don't have any way to turn for salvation without turning to God for salvation. That is the truth. That's what Jesus was here for, and that's what Jesus came to do. There's a lot of times I've heard, you know, somebody saying, well, you know, if you're a sinner, all you have to do is ask for salvation. Well, also, you need forgiveness. You need to have that forgiveness. So, what we do a lot of times is hear somebody in church say, well, you know, all I have to do is ask forgiveness for my sins. Well, that's just a step. That's just one step. You don't ask for salvation if you're just asking for forgiveness. You have to invite Jesus into your heart to have that salvation. So that's important to know. You can sit in church all your life and ask forgiveness for every sin you've ever done every week. You can ask forgiveness, but you're missing out on the truth about your salvation and about where you're going, because you're lying to yourself if you don't think that you have to have Jesus in your heart to get to heaven. Now, when we go and help others, is our truth really that helpful if we're telling people all they're doing wrong? It is the truth to point out everything that everybody's doing wrong, but that's not the truth that we're sent out to talk about. We're sent to tell the truth. We take the truth to people, the truth, Jesus, which is love. And this is one thing that always gets me on the messages that I give. I told my wife, I said, the reason God wants me to preach is because being in the Marines and everything like that, like I was, I'm not afraid to tell people the way it is. God's never put a message on my heart to be harsh with people like the Marine Corps taught me to be. It's always been about love. And the truth is love. Jesus is love. I've done jail ministries in the past. Well, I've been in jail in the past. There's a lot of things you don't know about me that if you did know about me, you probably wouldn't want me up here giving the message. But you know what? God appointed me. I didn't appoint myself, trust me. There's been plenty of times I've told Cheryl, I said, why didn't God just choose me to be some kind of evangelist, just run all over the place and not be bound and not be settled down in one spot? Well, you know, I'm not settled down in one spot because I go where God leads me to go, and this is where he's led me. But the one thing that I've seen in jail ministries is a lot of preachers like to get up there and tell them guys the truth about everything they've done wrong to end up in jail. I'm going to tell you something about the truth about ending up in jail that anybody that's ever been in jail can tell you real fast. I learned the truth about what I did wrong to get in jail the minute the police showed up. I learned the truth about what I did wrong about being in jail the minute they put the handcuffs on me. I didn't need some preacher to come into church and yell at me and tell me about everything I've done wrong. It's the truth. I did wrong. I got locked up for it. But I didn't need a preacher to come in there and tell me that. I already knew that, like I said, when the police showed up. I knew I was in trouble. I didn't need to hear that truth. That truth was already there presenting itself in front of me every time I looked up and found that the door that was holding me in that cell was locked and I couldn't go of my own free will. So that's not the truth that we're talking about when we go out to minister to other people. It's very important to tell people either you're saved or you're not. You're going to heaven or you're going to hell. But a lot of times as Christians, we like to put conditions on that. And the conditions are not the truth. Okay, if you smoke marijuana, you're going to hell. No. If you're not saved, you're not going to heaven. You're going to hell. There is a hell. But as God is cleaning you up and grooming you for the ministry that God calls you to be in, you don't really know exactly what God is really grooming you up for until you start doing it. And there's been so many times when I was growing up that the truth that I would hear from other Christians is stuff I already knew to be the truth. I already knew if I was sneaking my aunt's cigarettes, my aunt Sarah, I'd try to sneak her cigarettes sometimes. My aunt Mary, I'd steal her cigarettes sometimes. But it wasn't just me, it was my cousins and everything. And we'd go out there and try to sneak and smoke a cigarette. Now when I got caught doing that, I didn't need anybody to tell me that whipping I was getting at the time was because I stole a cigarette. I already knew that to be my truth as a person who done something wrong. But see, it's always that person that comes to you in love that you will receive the message from. Somebody running at me with a switch or a belt and trying to chase me down and whip me as I'm running from the truth. How many times are we running from the real truth? The truth that we should be paying attention to. The truth that we should be going out there and telling people. And I found out that to go and preach in a jail ministry or anything like that, you get a whole lot more people wanting to hear what you have to say if you talk to them just like I'm talking to you right now. They don't need to know they've done something wrong. They know they live it the whole time they're in there. They know they've done something wrong. Why can't we tell them what they can start doing right? Don't tell them, well, you got to stop doing this, you got to stop doing this, you got to stop doing this. No. Start doing this. And all that other stuff will work itself out.
Amen.
There's peace in that. To go to somebody else and let them know everything that they're doing wrong that's causing problems in their life, that's condemnation, and that's not what we're supposed to do. Now see, and that's when we run into that whole thing about being judged. The truth is, as Christians, the truth is, we're going to be judged. But our truth is, we already know that because the Bible says it. It says we will be hated for what we do. But in our minds, we sit there and say, well, we know the real truth. I have Jesus in my heart. regardless of what they say. Oh, this biker church down the road, but bunch of cult people. Police always over here. We're worthless. Look at the way they dress. Look at, you know, none of that stuff really matters. The truth is what we have right here in our heart.
Amen.
See, the one thing I can always say now, and it used to bug me for people to talk about me, that'd be a fight right there. I'd go confront them and ask them right to their face. And sometimes I wouldn't get the truth about what was actually said, because there's always confusion in that type of things. When you're doing stuff like spreading rumors or talking bad about somebody else, by the time it gets back to you, there's so much stuff been added to it and so many other things been said about it that there's confusion in that. There's no confusion in the actual truth about my Lord and Savior. You either are or you ain't. But see, the one thing that I can honestly think about now, when I have to sit there and worry about people judging me because of who I was and because of the life I lived before and because of the mistakes I still make now, my truth is I'm trying my best. My truth is in my heart. That Holy Spirit's there. I invited it in. And I can go share that with other people. And there's peace in that. There's no peace in conflict when I'm sharing rumors with other people, sharing gossip, things like that. But there is peace when I'm going out and sharing the Word of God with people. Whether they receive it or not, I'm still doing what I was called to do, and there's peace in that. The judgment that other people put on me, one of the first things is I keep hearing from people that knew me in my past, now that they've got the word that I'm preaching now, you know, they pretty much tell me all the time, oh, I told so-and-so you was preaching, and their first thing was, who? Him? How in the world's he doing that? Well, God's helping me. God's supporting me. And God's giving me all the tools I need to do what he's called me to do. But unless I know the truth, and unless I tell others the truth, I'm not doing what God called me to do. The faults that you feel like you have within yourself, that's not the truth. The faults that you feel like you have within yourself is just the rough edges that God's polishing up. If you ever want to relate anything that you do to what God's doing in your life, take on a project that you really have your heart into and watch the progress go. It's a work in progress all the time. Funny thing is once I get something that I'm working on, I like to make canes and do little things like that. But you know, once I get the cane that's just getting too far out of the way and not going to be able to be used what I want it to be used, I can start on another cane. That's not necessarily saying I'm starting on another person. It's meaning that the faults and all on that one is just like when you ask forgiveness. The faults are gone and God starts rebuilding on you. God will never toss you away and God will never turn his back on you. God don't look at sin because he can't. God's not going to put anything on you that's not good. A lot of people say that God's punishing me. God's not going to punish you right now. God is not in that stage right now in our lives and in where God sent Jesus to die for our sins and Jesus taught us how to love and all. We're not in that part of the Bible right now where God is just being so vengeful towards us. We're in that part of the Bible where Jesus came and set an example of showing us how to be and showing us how to love. Now, when the time comes that God's going to come back and be vengeful, that's when it's really important to understand that we either did our job or didn't do our job as disciples about going out there and sharing the word with other people. Because right now, what you do can be forgiven.
Amen.
But there's going to come a time, we may not see it in our lifetime, we may see it starting tomorrow, we may see it when we walk out of there today, we may see this. But there is going to come a time to where it's too late for forgiveness. And those are the times there to where we can sit back and be glad that we received Jesus in our hearts.
Amen.
But what we're striving for now that we've received Jesus in our hearts, and if you haven't received Jesus in your heart yet, we're here all day to help you with that. We've got business cards, we've got people in here that will help you with that. It doesn't take a preacher to get you saved. All it takes is someone to care enough about you to say, just ask Jesus into your heart. Tell God you believe that Jesus died for your sins and ask forgiveness. There's no secret to it. But see, the thing is, what we're looking for in our salvation now is when we get up there to heaven, we're looking for that job well done. My faithful servant. That's what we should strive for. There's a lot of times, and when I was growing up, I was always taught that the preacher was kind of unapproachable for me because I was a kid. If I had a question, I didn't need to bother the preacher with it. You know, as a kid having questions, as a child growing up, and want answers for things, you know, it was like, you're just a kid. You can't bother that preacher. That preacher's too important. Well, that's not the truth. That's not the truth. I'll tell you right now, as a preacher, and this could be going against what some other preachers or other churches believe, but as a preacher, I work for the congregation. I'm not the leader of this church. God's the leader of this church. And what comes next in the order of rank in our church is God, the church, and then the pastor, because the pastor works for that church. And if anybody has anything that they need to have a question about, whether it be a child, whether it be somebody that's already asked the question but they don't quite understand the answer they got, then that's what I'm here for. If I'm not approachable, if I'm not someone that you can come to and ask questions or ask for guidance on, then I've not told the truth. Jesus told all of his disciples when he ascended, he told them that they were all his friend. And seeing that's how we operate here. I can't put myself above anybody else. The reason I stand up to preach to you is out of respect for God, but I'm not standing over anybody. I'm just standing up to speak to everybody. But the truth of the matter is, this position right here that I hold in this church is one of the easiest positions to get replaced in. Don't do what God called you to do. You'll find out. Don't tell the truth. And as long as I'm up here, my prayer for you is to keep me along the lines of that. Now, one of the ways that I can try to explain to you about how this works in a church with the pastor and the church body and the elders of the church and everything else is one of the ways that I understand it myself, and that was what I was taught in the military. If you guys ever watched those old Vietnam movies or anything like that, where it shows a rifle squad going out into the jungle, and they've always got the man up in the very front that's up ahead of everybody a little ways. Well, see, that's kind of like what the preacher's job is. Now, the person that's all the way up there is not the leader. He's the one that's been appointed to be up there to watch out for anything that might come against them. Now, the church body would be that commanding group in that rifle team that's all working together to get the same thing. And the one that's out there, they call it the point man, man on point. And the one thing the point man looks out for is anything that's going to affect that church group in a way to make them under attack. And see, a lot of times the point man, he don't volunteer for that job. He is volunteered for it through the main body that's back here. He gets picked to do that. And see, a good point man, he'll probably survive, you know, as long as he's doing what he's supposed to be doing. Look down for trip wires, look all the way up for anything that's up in the trees or up in front of him or anything on side to side, and make sure that church body's not going to come under attack in any direction. That's why they go ahead the way they go. But see, the biggest way to understand what I'm getting at on that is that is the person that everybody in that group is counting on to keep them safe, to keep them in the Word, and to keep them from coming under attack from anything that goes on around them. So the one thing that we need to understand about the pastor and the church is it doesn't matter what time, day or night, doesn't matter how busy the person may appear. If God has put something on your heart to go to the pastor of the church, go to them.
Amen.
If they turn you away, then that's not the truth. We have a job as disciples to go out into the world and make other disciples. But when we come into the building here, that we gather, our church gathers together in the chapel here, then we're here for each other. Anything that we can do out there to expand the kingdom of heaven, by the way, we expanded the kingdom of heaven. We didn't do it, or God did it, but you know, we had salvation here just this past Sunday. I'm tickled to death about that. He's a real good friend of mine. But it just made it important to me to explain to people, we've been taught so many things that aren't the truth when we were growing up and when we've been out there in the world and while others have went out there to try to make this position or other people in the church to try to make their position or their salvation hang over the heads of other people who don't have it. That's deception. And that pushes people away. And what we do in our ministry is we try to pull people in. And the way to do that is through the truth, which is love. To point out people's faults to them and tell them you can't do this and it's going to keep you from heaven, that's condemnation. And one of the things that you'll find out that Jesus said, I've not come to condemn the world, but that the world through me might be saved. So we have to fix those problems that so many people had growing up. Like I said, there's so many things that I can remember from my childhood growing up to where had I known the truth then, it might have made a bigger difference in my life now.
Amen.
But the funny thing is all the things I've experienced in my life, in my sinful past, has helped me be a better person to serve God in the way that He's having me serve Him now. There's so many different things in your life where you make a decision that could point you in the opposite way of where God wants you to go, but all the experience you gain on that end that's not good experience, like sinful experiences and all, when you do hit that point and make that change, all that can be used to help others that's in the same position that you were in. And God uses that to take to others. So just remember when we're out there, the truth is easy to walk away from, but hard to come back to. It's just like people who knew the truth with Jesus and walked away. It makes it even harder for them to come back. The only way you can bring that back is through love and not condemnation. Brother David, would you like to dismiss us in prayer?
Father in heaven, thank you, Father, for your word. Help us, Lord, to take that word into our hearts, to be your servants, Father. Direct us in all things. Let the Holy Spirit guide us, Father. And I give you thanks, Father, for your word today. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Amen. Now we're going to go through the prayer requests. I put a few prayer requests myself in that spiritual ammunition box back there. And, you know, that's what it's for. Just so you know that those prayer requests do get prayed for. If you get into a situation that you want someone to come and visit a person that you put on the prayer list, we have people that can do that too. We have a whole ministry set up to do that. So just let us know on that. And also, you don't have to put your information on that either. You can also put an unspoken prayer request because God knows what it is. The important thing for us to know when we do something like that, that is representative of us putting something in because God knows the need. So let's just remember that. But also, if we have anyone that needs prayer today, we're open for business. Is there anyone that needs prayer?